Thank you all for spending 3 days with us. It's been a long journey for some of us. We began on Monday with the help of Sedale Olesia, an investigative journalist from Ecuador, from Colombia, from Nigeria, from Mali, South Africa, Guatemala, Colombia, experts, all of them. And I would invite them all to join us in this final discussion. I will, of course, begin by introducing the two new panelists we have with us here. First, we have Professor Elisabeth Eide, who is a professor here at Oslo and Akershus University College, but is also a vice president of that. President of Penn.
Vice chair, you can make it more modest.
A very modest vice chair of Penn Norway. And we also have with us one of the most experienced investigative journalists in Norway, Siri Gedde-Dahl, who now works for the magazine Kapital. And for the foreigners here, I must add that while Kapital might sound like a Marxist publication, it's not strictly speaking Marxist. So let's begin with you. We touched upon the many problems of openness in Norway. Even though we somehow imagine that we live in a very open society, there are surely problems also to be found for investigative journalists here in Norway.
Okay. Hello, can you hear me? Yes. Well, as Arne Jensen said in his speech, you feel a little ashamed as a Norwegian journalist in this company where people tell about so serious problem being an active journalist. I've been quite a few times paid by the ministry and the foreign ministry to have speeches abroad about transparency in Norway, and I feel a little ashamed when they. I mean, there are journalists that get arrested, and I'm telling about details in the Freedom of Information Act lists I don't get, and so forth. But still, there is some common kind of problems, and Arne Jensen was talking about some of them, which is basic infrastructure for an investigative journalist. Company registered, good company registers, business registers with access to annual accounts, to access to ownership, real owners, and he told about this fight we had to get access to a searchable online register, which is open information, but they wouldn't give us access to. But I think that's an international challenge to get this good ownership register all over the world, and not only nominee ownership, but real ownership. And we're fighting for that in Norway, where even in the Norwegian Stock Exchange you can hide back behind the nominee account. And that we all of us need that. And good property registers. We have a good property register here, but it's very, very expensive. We're working on that, and it's happening something there. But I think that's it's important for me in Norway to have a good property register in Kosovo or in Africa when I follow Norwegian companies out there. So this is an international challenge that both ways would profit on. Then we have this Freedom of Information Act, which is a very good law internationally compared. But our main fight is to make the authorities follow it, to follow the rules. And there are still, I wouldn't go in details on that, I could follow up on it, but it is a fight, because all kind of power, they kind of like dark corners. So, okay, and just to mention three more things, and one is source protection, which is important all over the world. I think the cases we have had in court shows that the source protection is strong for us legally here. And hidden identity protection, when you work as a journalist with a good reason, it's also good on the legal basis in Norway. But what is really bad is whistleblower protection. That's too bad in Norway. Both the attitude towards whistleblowers and the law protection they have. Okay.
One of the issues we have been discussing, especially yesterday, was how dependent we as journalists in Norway or in Europe are on whistleblowers elsewhere, Panama or Luxembourg or elsewhere. Do you feel that we do enough to help those people when they are really in trouble, because some of them are.
Society don't know, but I find very interesting your when you talked, the Financial Times talked about the whistleblower distinctions there. But I think, the international president of Transparency said in an interview I had with him, he said that organized crime has been all through history. There are sources on the inside that has been the most important source to reveal organized crime, and that's very in the time today with the Panama Papers and all these things. And I agree that you need to even if they do illegal things to get the stuff out, if it's a good reason for it, you shouldn't punish them. That's got not good enough framework for not even in Norway.
And Norway has been engaged in a number of solidarity cases, no? Supporting not only journalists, but also authors and filmmakers and others. Among them, Edward Snowden. So for you, I guess that international solidarity would be something important.
There's a strong issue for me. I don't know which hat to wear. Maybe I have one upon the other in this conversation. But to start with, one of the main issues for us is to fight the cultures of fear that we see in countries such as Afghanistan, where I've worked a lot, where lines are drawn in various ways. So we've just heard the example of Ethiopia, and also from Pakistan. I had a very recent article today from Financial Times, actually, by Ahmed Rashid. I'd like to quote just from that a little bit, because it's a very interesting article about Twitter and Pakistan. He writes that the unprecedented use of Twitter has led to a major threat to media freedom in Pakistan. It bars journalists from asking any questions, provides no transparency, and then encourages state censorship on issues the government does not want to discuss. Any subject, furthermore, he says, that is not raised on the Twitter feed by either the army, the government, or others, is considered off-limit. And this means that the current Prime Minister of Pakistan, Nawaz Sharif, has not held a single press conference for his 3 years in office. He prefers to communicate by tweets, which cannot be challenged in the same manner as you can. I mean, you have a story, you want to confront power. How do you do that? By tweeting to the Prime Minister? Well, so, I mean, the culture of fear and the various ways in which that works. In Afghanistan, journalists that we know of have, for example, met with authority figures who said, you know, I could get you a half-year prison sentence if you publish this and that. And then, of course, the self-censorship is a rampant issue. In my own institution, we have a research institute that has recently revealed that state employees, such as Roy and myself, are increasingly feeling loss of freedom in their daily work. And that is an issue, because that also means that for you journalists who might want to interview us, maybe not Roy and me, because we are quite outspoken, but other of our colleagues might then refuse or refrain from doing so precisely for that reason. So that is an issue to put it also back home. But to put it out again to the more endangered world, I think one of the answers given earlier in an earlier panel today was about the authorities not feeling that it helps, for example, to cut aid or such. But on the other hand, does it help to just say we are worried or concerned, which seems to be the main diplomatic vocabulary or rhetoric of today? We are worried, we are concerned. When 1,000 people are killed in Ethiopia, you get worried. Maybe you should get shocked. I mean, there is sometimes a reason to break with a certain very low-key rhetoric in dealing with governments elsewhere to curtail the press freedom, I feel. I think it's a very important issue, actually. Last but not least, John, you raised the issue of Snowden, so I can't refrain from addressing it myself. And now I'll put off the pen hat and talk as a media researcher, because what I found researching with one of my students also is that the Norwegian press almost unanimously recognized Snowden as a whistleblower. But not only that, also the liberal conservative largest newspaper in Norway, where Siri used to work, in their editorial supported the nomination of Snowden for the Nobel Peace Prize. So I think the press situation in Norway on this issue is quite a unique case compared to, for example, UK, where Independent was different from The Guardian, no doubt. And it is unique because the press field here deviates from the political field, which was largely silent on the issue. Last but not least, we live in a post-truth society, to rely on secret services, as you say, when post-truth was really introduced by the pretext for the Iraqi war in 2003, do we have reasons to trust these institutions? I'm afraid I'm not in that position, at least. So I think we should give Snowden the benefit of the doubt. And the way you hint at him eventually allied with Russia or revealing his secrets to Russia, I think as long as we don't have any proof or evidence for that, that remains speculative to a certain extent, no?
Yesterday, when we discussed the LuxLeaks, one of the most well-known international lawyers in the field told us that we must be careful to separate the real whistleblowers from those that are abusing whistleblowing to do harm. What kind of, what should we expect from a real whistleblower or leaker?
I think if we compare to earlier, to WikiLeaks, Snowden took care to exactly respect professional journalists and give the material to journalists he thought and knew, I guess, more or less, would take a special care of this material and not reveal things that would put individuals and others in danger. So that is, I think, an important feature with Snowden, actually. On the other hand, when we've talked about how equipment has been destroyed in USSR, I think it's an interesting revelation that also the Guardian equipment was destroyed by the British police and is now on display in Victoria and Albert Museum if it's not taken off. I mean, this kind of naivety when it comes to thinking that you can, in a modern electronic world, just attack some machines as if we were living in the early industrial revolution. That is an issue. So I was also thinking about the whistleblower Snowden compared to Ellsberg, which was an issue that you, John, raised. It's an important issue to raise, and they've actually acted together, and Ellsberg very much supports Snowden. But Ellsberg, he dealt with papers. He didn't live in the digital age, and these parallels are a bit limping, I think.
So I would have to ask you now, John, do you think that the difference in opinion, which Elisabeth talks about, between the Norwegian media and perhaps the British media, is due to culture, or how do you see that?
I don't read the Norwegian media.
No, you're excused there.
I don't read the Norwegian media. In the case of the UK, rather like in other countries as well, possibly most of all the United States, I mean, you have a fairly well-defined conservative media and a fairly well-defined leftist liberal media. And they take, usually on most things, predictable stances. And in this, more or less, they follow that. Conservative media were at least skeptical of the NSA leaks. And the liberal, especially the Guardian, which was the first to print, and I think printed more than in any other publication, apart perhaps from Spiegel in Germany, were for him, by and large. I mean, there were some reservations which the Guardian entered, but by and large they were for him. I think that's a relatively healthy state of affairs, that you have newspapers, the two most powerful newspapers in terms of circulation in the UK are tabloids. Indeed, the UK tabloid press is very powerful, politically powerful press, but the Daily Mail and the Sun, which are selling around about 2 million, a little more sometimes, a little less sometimes, each are both very conservative and tended, I think, to be against Snowden, although the Mail itself is there. So yes, the differentiation is essentially political, and Snowden's leaks went down the right-left axis.
After listening to Olesya's presentation, how do you see the future for investigative, independent, autonomous journalism in Russia?
Oh, I think if we've got people like her, it'll last. but it'll last with great difficulty. I mean, she didn't say off her paper, Novaya Gazeta, that what, 10, 12 people have been killed over, not in the last few weeks, but over the years. So it's, you know, she's clearly a courageous woman simply working there, let alone doing anything for it. And Anna Politkovskaya is the icon, but she was a very brave woman indeed. for her reporting to Chechnya, but there are many others like her who are less. So to pick up your laptop and do investigative journalism in Russia is to court at least discomfort now. And as I said when I was speaking, most journalism in Russia is suppressed. Most independent journalism is suppressed. That's by far the most popular in Russia as elsewhere source of news, current affairs, debates, and so on is television. Television is extremely strongly suppressed, and much of it is pure propaganda, and doesn't contain any investigative journalism apart from that which shows up the enemies of the state in a bad light. Russia Today, RT, the foreign broadcaster, will do investigative journalism as long as it shows that somebody in the United States, preferably, or in Western Europe, is in some way degraded. It's pointed at a particular target, rather like the WikiLeaks leak of the Democratic National Committee. It's not there for revelation, it's there as a weapon.
Arne, from a Norwegian editor's point of view, are Norwegian editors slightly different from other editors? Especially thinking about whistleblowers and
snow. I don't know if I can answer that question really. Maybe. But what I was about to say is just a couple of remarks on protection of sources. And I agree with Siri, of course, that legally the protection of sources in Norway has been strengthened the last 15 years. Years, mostly because of verdicts from the Supreme Court. They have been very good at this. But the problem is, you can strengthen the protection of sources legally, but actually, in the same 15 years, you have had lots of new laws giving more tools to the police, to the Secret Service, to the Department of Defense, and all this intelligence. So the protection of sources are undermined from behind. That's the real challenge. There's a new law coming up now. It's called Digital Border Defense. My God, sorry. This is really something. They're going to collect massive amounts of information, and not only communication data, but the actual content of the messages. This is not 1984, it's much worse. Then to Snowden. The Association of Editors in Norway supported Snowden in his law case against the government of Norway to get safe access to Norway to receive the Osietzky Prize. Given to him by Norwegian pen, where Elisabeth is. Take off the hat.
We're bored of 11 persons.
I don't know all the details in the Snowden case, but the question, you can make it, I think, a bit more simple. Would we prefer to be without the information that Edward Snowden provided to us? Mm-hmm. No. I would certainly not. So thank you, Edward Snowden. Thank you very much for giving us some real essential information about the world that we're living in and how it works. And now you can go back to the US and be put to prison for the rest of your life. I don't like the idea of those two things. It's not, you have one ass, ride one horse. So I think that's a bit difficult. And when it comes to whistleblowers, there are problems with, of course, with whistleblowers, some of them. Lots of them don't have good motives for what they're doing. They want to make a hassle, they want to hurt someone, they want to promote themselves, or how do I know? But it's rather challenging to give some kind of moral way of judging whether a whistleblower should have protection or not. I think we should look more to what kind of information has been disclosed, because I'm not that interested in the motives.
I could see that you wanted to make a comment, Elisabeth, on the protection of sources.
Yes, I did, because very recently we saw how journalism solidarity can work in revealing just that border control issue, because there were journalists in 7-8 countries, and journalists from Aftenposten, the largest newspaper in Norway, who, well, she actually used to work for Stavanger Aftenblad, but in the same consortium. So they are all revealing these things and questioning them and challenging authorities on the issue, and they're doing it jointly. So I think that's a very good example. But while I'm at the protection of sources, there's another issue too, which is related to what I just said about state employees. Because in the state institutions, if you like, there is an increasing refeudalization in the sense that fewer and fewer bodies are elected, more and more people are employed, and which means the accountability moves upwards, loyalty is upwards, and not to the people who eventually, at least before, used to elect you. Because now you're employed by the people up there. And that also, I think, entails that people censor themselves more because the repercussions might be worse than before, I think.
One of the topics we have been discussing a lot over the last 2 or 3 days is the global flows of capital, finance. And as we know, Norway, the official pension fund of Norway, is the largest investment fund in the world. But it's quite difficult actually to investigate the big transactions. How would you say Norwegian journalists are managing?
not good enough. I was about to say something about the challenge that the Norwegian journalists should grab, because there's I think it's what can improve investigative journalism and follow the money, good journalism. I think Norwegian journalists too much lean on the pillow of a bad economy in the media, and they don't grab the challenge to find new ways and to spend a life. Too many of them spend a life as an entertainer in a right-leadership society instead of following the money. And one thing that Norwegian journalists are too bad to do is following like the pension funds money all over the world, and as I mentioned, then again the registers and the cooperation with the foreign journalists are basic, and to follow Norwegian companies all over the world, like Yara company, fertilizer company that has businesses all over the world, are big in Africa, for example. We don't follow them, and there are big corruption cases going on that, and like Statoil, the oil company, and like the Norwegian aid, which is huge in many countries. We're not good at that at all.
It's quite expensive to do that type of journalism.
Yeah, one of the things that we could benefit on is more cooperation with foreign journalists.
And since we have John, who's got a long history with Financial Times, we might ask you, how would you do that if you were a journalist in Norway and somehow feeling a social responsibility for the world's largest global fund, which is everywhere, in Colombia, it's in Guatemala, but it's also in Angola.
In London,
of course. Maybe owning a few of the houses in that building we saw on the slide earlier. How would you go about doing that?
How go about investigating it?
Yes.
Well, I mean, what can you do? You can hope that somebody leaks. How to investigate it? You can hope that someone leaks, and I'm sure somebody has done or will do. You do what normally you do when you look for leaks. That is, you look for somebody who's been fired or has left under a cloud of some kind, or has gone out because they were their boss shouted at them, somebody who has got a grudge. Now, that's obviously they might talk, at the same time they might talk too much, or they might say things which are not true because they are angry. However, they are always being valuable sources. And then you go over the literature, which is, as we said earlier, increasingly complex. You have to either yourself or with colleagues who are trained accountants and more forensic investigators, you have to go over what they publish and follow the money. Because I would guess in the case of the Norwegian Fund, following the money is the largest part of it. To do it properly for a fund of that size would take a long time. And you'd have to dedicate yourself, and your editor would have to dedicate you or you and the team to do it. The size of the fund seems to me to make it worthwhile. I'm surprised if it hasn't been done, maybe it has been done. As far as I'm aware, it hasn't been done by the Financial Times, but it's a good idea to do, and I shall mention it.
Since we have a representative, the editor, let's call you that, how do you see the social responsibility of Norwegian editors and newspapers and television changing when Norwegian businesses are getting more and more international and are investing more and more abroad, also in places which are really difficult for Norwegian journalists to work in?
Of course, as Siri said, we are not good enough. And the problem is, of course, that the more Norwegian companies go abroad and the more the Norwegian aid spreads out and engages itself in several countries, the more difficult it is actually to look into it, because it's spread in so many countries. And we know that even in Norwegian media, the resources are being more limited in the newsrooms. So it's a challenge, but I think, like John says, it's if you want to do it, you have to dedicate. You have to pick some projects and dedicate journalists to this project. Don't think you can give the whole picture of the say Norwegian aid. I think that's almost too ambitious. But you can pick out some projects and go into them. The problem is knowing which ones, because let's be honest, we like to come out with something else that everything is okay.
Elisabeth has been educating journalists for a few decades, let's say that. So how do you feel journalism education about handling these issues?
Well, I'd say that what is important now to the students that I face nowadays compared to the ones I faced, let's say, 25, 26 years ago, is that they no longer adhere to one joint public sphere. I think I see some former students in the audience who might remember the good old days where we had read the same news the day before, we could discuss the same TV news the day after. Nowadays, it's a totally different world. And that also has to do with what I mentioned briefly, the post-truth culture that we see spreading now, in the sense that we need a very much increased media literacy among our students, but also among students and people in general, to be able to distinguish between falsities and established journalistic truths that have been faithfully dug out in a muckraker tradition, for example. I think that is vital, because I think with the way in which media outlets are done now, it will not be easy for everyone to distinguish, and that is a danger. So the question has been asked, what has been done to improve the conditions of investigative journalism? I think we have something to defend. I think we're mostly on the defensive now, at least where we come from here. But there are things we can do, and one of the things has to do with rich countries' responsibility. And of course, what I say now is purely a dream, because this fantastically rich foundation that we have, this oil fund, pension fund, maybe if there was just a small fragment of that used in a kind of pro bono way to support institutions elsewhere, independent journalist institutions, where they can survive. Sometimes they have to survive in exile, we know that. We've seen Democratic Voice of Burma, for example, the way they operated outside of Burma under dictatorship. We now see what you are facing in Ethiopia. I mean, if we could just think of, I mean, something is happening. Norway is supporting some of these independent institutions, but it could be done in a larger way, because that would be a real solidarity from a rich country, and that could also then help, as we try to do with an international center that we recently have established in our department called the JMIC, J-M-I-C, Journalism Media International Center, where we try to congregate journalists from many different countries who then build bridges of trust between each other. So instead of only thinking about fighting cultures of fear, we can build these bridges of trust where we can work together. So a Norwegian journalist who can't travel due to financial constraints can couple up with a journalist in Pakistan or Afghanistan, or be it Uganda or elsewhere, and do the story.
I saw that you wanted to comment on that.
I wanted to agree with Elisabeth for once in her saying we should accentuate the positive. And I think we've got a lot to be grateful for in our societies, in European societies and North American societies and some others. I have an Ethiopian friend who Sidali will know, the provenance, who you started with others, a newspaper some years ago called Addis Neger, which was then closed down, and they, the editors, the founders, had to flee in order to avoid long jail sentences on charges which were still pending against them of treason.
And they are sentenced.
Sorry?
They are sentenced to 8 years.
Yes, that's right.
In absentia.
In absentia. And when I talked to Abby and to others as well, some often from Russia and from other countries like that, you realize how lucky we are with our freedoms. And in many ways, these freedoms have increased. Who knows what's going to happen in the future, but in the last, decade, the internet has furnished us with more investigative journalism than has ever been available before. Huge amounts, especially in the United States, but also here in Europe and elsewhere. What had been a niche of journalism still is a niche, but it's a bigger niche. Mm-hmm. And it's funded not just by newspapers, which are, in a way, increasingly incapable of funding even themselves. It's funded increasingly by foundations. I guess in Norway, certainly in the UK, certainly in the US, where one of the biggest centers for investigative journalism is ProPublica, which is funded by actually a West Coast property millionaire who puts millions into it. And there are many, many others. Not just ProPublica is really national, based in New York, and does big national stories, but there are investigative websites, and indeed even magazines, have grown up recently, all over the United States. And the same is true elsewhere. So we're in a, very often you can say that journalism has never been better. It's never been better in the ubiquity of journalism, in the ability to get journalism free from a whole variety of sources, obviously the internet. Mainly, it's better because there's more long-form journalism being produced. There are new journalisms coming on stream, as it were. But in India now. Journalism which had been rather servile to the state is now becoming much more independent, much more interesting, and much more widespread in various languages. Unfortunately, in the other part of the world, what's happened in the last few years has been clamping down in Russia, in China, with Xi Jinping coming in and reproducing the attitude of Mao to journalism, in Egypt, where the Arab Spring lasted 2 or 3 years, and elsewhere, and Turkey, of course. So millions, hundreds of millions of people, having had a taste of quasi-free journalism, are now back on state journalism. We, against that, are in kind of paradise.
Mm. Since we are now discussing also Ethiopia and some of the other countries where we have really experienced journalists, I feel it would be good to try to include the audience in the debate there. And I would like to ask Tzedale first, if you could, because Ethiopia used to be the darling of the international society, gave a lot of aid to the government. How do you feel international society has supported you after the clampdown against journalists?
It's a disappointment. It's very disappointing because I was at the center of a committee in January formed by the U.S. Embassy to look for alternatives on how the government should engage with the protesting citizens. And we met Samantha Power and in a closed door, and we were very frank. We came up with 4 things that the government could possibly do to start talking to the people. And Gail Smith as well, the USAID chief now, And they seemed very convinced that that was an easy step for the government to take in order to talk to the people. And that was in January. And between January and October this year, while we have been talking that, the days couldn't stop, the killing and everything. And you could see that they're not comfortable because their interest comes first. And the kind of government that my country has today knows exactly how to engage with the donor community. So there are two things that are preventing the donor community as well. One is that the country functions in the name of sovereignty. The other is that they don't want to depict this country as a failure because it's donors' money that got it into where it is today. So they cannot face their taxpayers' community and say what we've been doing in the last 25 years is an utter failure. We propped up a government that's turning its guns against its own people. There's no courage to admit that. So they would still like to continue massaging and lullabying that government, even as they know that Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, and every other international rights organization have been, you know, continued releasing reports of deaths. I was reading a story yesterday on the Financial Times on DRC, where they have now imposed travel restrictions on some of the senior army officials and also asset freeze. We've been suggesting that because we understand that it's very difficult for them to severe and, you know, the diplomatic relationship or even to appear so hard on them, harsh on them. So they can continue cooperating their work, and Ethiopia can continue fighting their war in Somalia. That's fine. You know, as long as we have our sons and daughters coming home safe in one piece. But we said maybe you could play that leverage with this government as well. And nobody has done it. They have done it with DRC yesterday. And this is when you have to ask yourself, why? Because DRC is not geopolitically that important as Ethiopia is. So interest first. The others, maybe, maybe not. So this is how diplomacy functions. And it's very disappointing.
Perhaps the massive global aid to Ethiopia, especially to the Ethiopian government, would be one place where critical Norwegian journalism could begin, possibly.
I think it has been better done in the case of Afghanistan, which has some parallels, although I hate parallels, but a massive investigation, but now journalists very critical of what Norway did. Because the only conclusion was that they served the loyalty to the US.
I also wanted to ask a question to Lesia, which I just read in the largest business paper in Norway, Dagens Næringsliv, that several of the businessmen that has been mentioned in some of your stories are investing internationally, as you told us, and also in Norway. But how do you feel about that export of, or the financial flows flowing out of Russia, and perhaps also finding a safe haven in places like Norway?
As I said in my presentation, of course, we sad when we see that. I'm sad when I see, I don't know, databases more closed than in Russia. For example, Russia considered to be like closed country, right? But I can easily find ownership structure for almost every company in Russia. But when I go to US, and they see Delaware, right? It's totally closed. The same with lab records in many countries. So yes, we start when we see money invested in European countries, money from Russia, maybe those money, and we start when we cannot track that.
Thank you. And that allows me to ask Arne. The Ten Commandments, which were actually 11 commandments, seem so obvious. How can anyone be against that type of openness that makes it possible for those who wish to invest in a manner which is not open? How come there are such strong resistance against that type of openness in Norway?
Well, that's because people in power in Norway are... Well, it's because the politicians or they're businessmen or otherwise, they don't want to be looked into, they don't want to be investigated. They want to keep on doing their business and doing their jobs in peace. And power corrupts everywhere, also in Norway. I mean, we're not a separate part of the human race. It's basically shaped like everyone else. We just got a lot of oil and tried to make some kind of democracy. So I think it's as simple as that. Even in Norway, Siri can tell you more about that, but even in Norway, every day you meet people who say, well, what's the problem with this kind of information? Well, the problem is that it's a lot of noise, it's a lot of inconvenience, and worst case, it will disclose misuse of power.
I'll just comment on that, because we're working together in the Press Transparency Council. No politician in Norway would say they're against these commandments. Nobody, not at all. They would say they're great, and we have that. But in practice, it's not the same. So that's why we, even in Norway, feel we have to fight to keep the transparency and to make it strong all the time, even in Norway, because property information is very expensive. That means not everybody has access to it. The problem with the ownership register was that you could search on names on it, and you could very quick find connections, and the people and the state authorities have a fear of too much connection. Yes, you'll get the information, but not connected. Oh, that's dangerous. So there's many items we had to fight for.
I can see you wanted to comment.
I think if we're allowed to conclude on a positive note, I agree very much with John about some of his optimistic statements, because we see new business models in journalism from the individual sometimes kind of hybrid journalist doing important work, linking up with people elsewhere. And we see also larger institutions. You mentioned the ProPublica. You could mention also Intercept is also funded by a billionaire, Pierre Omidyar. And we could mention also crowdfunded institutions, more or less investigative, such as Tehelka.com in India started out. It has been through turbulent times, and God knows where it's going, but it has also had millionaires in its ranks. So it could, I mean, there are different ways of modeling nowadays, and we haven't seen the future yet. I think there is a lot of interesting things to come, but at the same time, we can be worried since the number of information officers and post-truth, non-truth forgers is increasing. That number is increasing, and that is a challenge.
We only have 1 minute left, so I think it's only fair that John, who has travelled far to get it, at least from England.
Britain, I'm Scots.
Get the last word then. You say that one thing that impressed me during your speech was you said that journalism is not enough. We need a society that cares about journalism. How do you see that in the future now?
How do I see it in the future?
Well, things are changing, aren't they?
By definition, but things are changing, and they always do, and we can never know the future. However, as far as we can look at the future, it does seem to be as though that journalism is changing its shape. It's also changing its function to a large extent. Part of that is driven by technology. Part of it, much of it, is driven by the increasing complexity of the world. I think that, and part of it too, is a separation, a greater separation than before, into particular strands or niches, so that people, more than before, although even before, conservatives read conservative papers, liberals, liberals, socialists, socialists, but I think more than before, people are being redesignated, rerouted, or are rerouting themselves into different strands of journalism. But I think the big breakthrough, and the one which we haven't mentioned all that much, is that now there are, whatever you call them, citizen journalists, people who do journalism, or do blogs, tweet. In other words, they express themselves, so that for my generation of journalists, the journalist was here and put things out. Now we put things out and things come back. And it's a very much different kind of media ecology which is growing up, and which is much more complex than before, more exciting than before, and seems to me will develop further. And there was a further development both of journalism by journalists and journalism by citizens. And may or may not be good, but I think much of it probably will be.
So, thank you all. To Arne Jensen, Siri Gedde-Dahl, Elisabeth Eide, and John Lloyd. Thank you for joining us.